Start the second half with a very, very special presentation. We are very grateful that Dr. Richard Oppenlander is here to join us today. He is the author of a very amazing book that is newly out called Comfortably Unaware, Global Depletion and Food Choice Responsibility. Dr. Oppenlander is a sustainability and wellness advocate, writer, and speaker committed to improving the health of our planet. He is the president and founder of an organic vegan food production and education business, an animal rescue operation, and has given hundreds of lectures, presentations, and open discussions on the topic of food choices. And we are so grateful he is here to talk about your role in global depletion. Please welcome Dr. Richard Oppenlander.
Thank you. Thank you. Well, thank you, Hope. That was wonderful. Very nicely done. And thank all of you for taking the time to come to this very important event. Is everybody in a good mood?
Yes.
Must be the food, huh? I think so. All right, well, what a tremendous globally relevant topic this happens to be. We probably should add a few more concepts to this theme phrase, though, such as grass-fed or pastured, real food, whatever that means, and aquaculture of fish. And before anyone can intelligently discuss conscious or mindful eating, there certainly needs to be a clearer and a more appropriate defining of that word, sustainable. Okay, let's start right off with the photo, shall we? All right, so what do you see here in this photo? Without reading too much into it, typically one would see beautiful blue skies, green grass, rolling hills, some fluffy white clouds, things like that. Yeah, well, we're gonna come back to that photo in a little bit, and we're gonna take a much closer look at it, so let's tuck it away for right now and make a little mental imprint of it. Now, I stopped eating animals nearly 40 years ago while I was in graduate school, primarily from a health, wellness, and environment standpoint, but also because of the animal research I was involved with at that time. And I still do quite a bit of animal research, but now it's related to the effect of our food choices. So now it's more of this type of animal research, perhaps in a jungle, a remote area, getting a better grasp on what sustainability really does in fact mean. So that would have to include researching animals like these, at some of the largest dairy operations in the world that I visited, and these, grass or pasture-fed livestock here in the U.S. and overseas in a number of countries. This happens to be in the U.K. This guy really likes me. I'm talking about the cow here, of course. And researching farms like these. And we certainly can't leave fish out of the equation now, can we? This happens to be in the Pacific Northwest, one of the larger fish farms there. Well, I became so concerned about the effect of our food choices that I developed some organic vegan food products, a food production business, some enlightenment protocols, a nonprofit organization recently, and even a couple of healthy fast food restaurants. I mean, basically, it was anything I could do to help improve the health of our planet with respect to food while I was lecturing along the way, because I realized very early on that it all begins with education, and not just mine, but everyone's. So we're going to examine the word sustainable pretty carefully today, not just because Dr. Davis asked me to, but we're going to do it anyway, because recently it's been morphed into so many different meanings to suit so many different needs. And it's the latest buzz. I mean, you see it everywhere you go. Everybody's talking about it. Now, I found that the word sustainable for most people refers to our energy sector, how many miles per gallon of gas your car can achieve, how many energy-efficient light bulbs you can switch out to save electricity, and to waste, how, what, and when to recycle. Often we think of economic sustainability or social sustainability, but in most areas of the world, no one really knows about, and they don't care to hear or talk about what effect our food has on our environment, especially a certain type of food. And that's because they're unaware, and they're pretty comfortable being that way, despite the enormous effect. It's also too challenging for everyone, culturally, socially, politically, economically. Now, I call all this global depletion, the loss of our primary resources on Earth, as well as our own health. It's still sustainability. I just think we need to hear it from a different direction, and I think we need to hear the whole story through an unfiltered lens. Now, how many here are familiar with the work of Jamie Oliver, Mark Bittman, of course, Michael Pollan? Yeah, about high fructose corn syrup, industrialization of foods, important, sure, yeah, but these are just fragments of the picture. We need to move well beyond all that and understand the entire picture, the sustainability of our planet, our resources, and ourselves. And to do this, we always need to include topics such as loss of biodiversity, world hunger, sustainability of our own health, of course, water scarcity, agricultural land use inefficiencies, and the state of our oceans and fish. It's a pretty long and potentially daunting list, isn't it? With food choice, or life in general, I think the key to understanding or solving a problem really begins with recognition that there is indeed a problem to solve. So maybe we should all view the Earth as one of us for a change. I mean, let's treat it as a patient. For instance, none of us are aware of our planet's cholesterol levels or cardiovascular condition, are we? And certainly most of us are not aware of all, at all, or even concerned about the increasing size of Earth's cancerous tumor or its sudden loss of weight. How about the failing lungs of our planet? Are we aware of those on a daily basis? This happens to be in Malaysia. Or the traumatic and permanent loss of one of our planet's fingers or arms or legs, things that we may never see again. I mean, the Javan and the Tasmanian tiger are already gone, and the Ridley sea turtle is on its way out, all because of what we choose to eat. And then there's the mental status. Are we aware of the severe psychosis our Earth is struggling with? Well, I mean, what else would you want to call it? We're now trying to fit a square dial into an undersized round opening. See, the answer to all that's no. I mean, we're not aware. Unfortunately, there are no annual checkups. The information about our planet's health hasn't been managed very well. It's not been related correctly to a specific type of food choice. And it's never a good idea to cover these things up. Once we're able to better communicate the reality of the state of our planet, the global depletion caused by our choice of foods, and once awareness levels are raised, well, then solving these issues and creating a truly healthy planet becomes easier, just like the patient. Well, the story begins with these two numbers, I think. I mean, there are 7 billion people living on our planet today, and control of the growth of our population is an issue, but it's not nearly so much of a problem as the number on the right, what we're currently doing to the planet. The number on the right represents, of course, the fact that there are more than 70 billion animals living on our planet that we raise and eat for food each year, and it repeats itself year after year in growing numbers, and that's the problem. In fact, this 70 billion number that you see is quite impossible, and I use that word correctly, it's quite impossible to pin down, because on any given day, you may find up to 1.7 trillion chickens in the world, or 1 to 2 trillion fish in the world on their way, sooner or later, going off to slaughter. Let's look at a graphic about global depletion. Certainly there are other industries that contribute to this picture that could fit in the middle here, but none have the comprehensive impact. And just how serious is this depletion? Well, it's very. It's very. In some cases, it's irreversible, and it's spiraling downward quickly. All of these systems that you see are affected. And simply put, we're demanding more of our planet's resources than what it can supply. It would currently take 1.5 to 2 full Earths to sustain what we're currently taking from and doing to our planet. Most of that's due to our choice of foods. It's serious enough on its own merit, but it's made much more so because of all the layers and layers of various influences that tend to bury the problem and bury its solutions. We just don't want to deal with it. I mean, we can put every other major problem in the world at the top of the list to fix except for this one, and yet this is the world. Now, what's critical for everyone to clearly understand is that this isn't just a factory farm issue. You're seeing that today. It's a raising animals to eat issue, and we're going to see that as we go along further today. Let's refine our thoughts on global warming. We need to remember that global warming is just one component of the much larger, more insidious problem of global depletion, the more total effect we have on our planet. And the most important thing that anyone can do about global warming or global depletion is take a very good look at what's on their plate, of course, specifically all foods derived from fish and livestock, and yes, that has to include dairy. So instead of 20%, as the original 2006 United Nations report stated by their LEAD committee, a number of researchers have now found that livestock can produce as much as 51% of all greenhouse gas emissions found in our atmosphere, mostly created by the respiratory carbon dioxide that wasn't accounted for at all in that first report, and by the methane production by these billions of animals themselves that was underreported, not due to confinement or as a byproduct of factory farming methods. Now, regardless of where the exact number resides, somewhere between 20 and 51%, it doesn't really matter because it's enormous. And the general public needs to know this. I mean, everyone certainly knows the ecological benefits of driving a Prius, right? But very few have the same awareness and concern about eating a steak or a burger or a fish or a chicken. Now, a perfect example of how this information is suppressed occurs every single year during our climate change summits, held originally in Kyoto with its 1997 Kyoto Protocol. And most recently, it was in December in Durban, South Africa, where countries have come together and they're trying, in a way, to solve this global warming problem, but none of this is being addressed. So it's very important for them at the summits and for everyone else to clearly understand that it won't matter how many light bulbs are changed out, and it won't matter how many hybrid cars there are on the road if we don't first change out the way we eat. Okay, interspersed throughout our discussions, you're gonna hear and see a few themes. One theme is how information about this particular subject has been suppressed, even mismanaged, so much so that objectives of many important meetings like Kyoto and other organizations are not being met. And that all begins, I think, with the words we use. I mean, how clear are they? Are they conveying reality? Do any of these terms that you see mean sustainable? Do any of them mean healthy? Well, many would want you to think so. And how about the word humane? Does humane equal sustainable? And if it does, which it doesn't, but if it does, who is it that's trying to define the word humane for all of us? Does anybody know? I do. And if the definitions are wrong, if any of these definitions are wrong, well, then the movements themselves will be wrong, won't they? So, for instance, what does real food mean? Who defines it? Well, it's a pretty large movement. We need to be aware of it. But I have some serious issues with its precepts. It's a nice overall idea, but I have some issues with its precepts. I happen to have the definition of real food right off the Real Food Challenge website here with me. Let's see. Real food is defined by four core categories. The product has to be local or community-based. That makes sense. It has to be fair. That's pretty good. Ecologically sound or sustainable. And humane. There we go again. So let's see. The product has to be local, fair, sustainable, and humane. All right, so perfect. If you live anywhere near Detroit, this is real food, isn't it? Oh, come on. It is too. Local, fair, humane, sustainable, especially after it's charged up for a few hours, it fits. Or if you live anywhere near the beach, try this. This could be considered real food according to their own definition. Take your pick. It's local. All of them are local. You know, just because something's local doesn't at all mean that it's healthy. Doesn't mean that it's sustainable. Certainly doesn't mean that it even should be eaten. So the point is obvious, that it all begins with the words we use. Are they conveying reality? Let's look at the word just food, for instance, since that's the topic of the day, isn't it? My definition of the word food is that which is consumed to ultimately nourish and support life. So many people find many different reasons to eat food and lots of it, and it depends how selfish you want to make that definition. But knowing that, therefore, it's ultimately to support life. So knowing that, therefore, animals are not food. Animals are not food unless you choose to eat them. And even then, they really don't fit the definition, do they? To support life? Now, animals are in fact animals. They're also not meat. I mean, meat, I found, is a term contrived and used by humans to obscure the reality of what we choose to put in our mouths. I mean, think about it. In fact, now there's so many subterms and cute words for this meat category for almost every type of meat that you actually lose track of what you're eating. Certainly where it came from, or what resources it took to produce it. So let me explain. Picture yourself just like a few minutes ago at lunchtime, just about anywhere other than here, of course. And if you turn to the person on your right and you ask them what they're eating, and they happen to be eating a cylindrical encased mishmash of various animal parts called a hot dog. And you ask them what they're eating, well, the response is gonna be, I'm eating local, aren't I? I'm eating real food and I'm eating a hot dog. So what exactly do they mean by that, they're eating a hot dog? Well, are they eating this? No. No, I don't think so, and yet this is a really good-looking dog. He's a hot dog. Yeah, he is. No, what they're really eating is the cute guy on the right here. He's finally found someone nice to take a snooze with. That's what they're eating. They're eating a pig, or parts of a pig, and yet you never hear that from them. If you ask them what they're eating, they're eating a hot dog, they never respond by saying, I'm eating this pig's leg. No, they just wouldn't say that, would they? And yet if you turn to the person on your left, and they happen to be eating an apple, or something similar, and you ask them that very same question, hey, dude over there, what are you eating? Well, they're gonna respond by saying, you know, you gotta stop calling me dude. And secondly, I'm eating an apple. It's just straight up, isn't it? It's an interesting thing to think about. And another term of many that's constantly used improperly, if not abused, and I hear this every single day, and so do you, it's this. It's a protein. Perhaps a rudimentary protein, doesn't have the secondary and tertiary molecular characteristics of a protein, but essentially it's a protein. So when you're thinking about eating a protein, this is what you should be thinking about, as in, I need to get my protein today, right? Yeah, well, protein is not the little buddy on my shoulder, looking over my shoulder here. I mean, that's my research assistant. A good one, too. Protein's also not the guy on the left here, and yet that's what people are calling protein, aren't they? The guy on the left with the overzealous smooch and the excessive amount of saliva that he always has? Well, he's a cow. I mean, he shouldn't be called protein. He shouldn't be called protein any more than the guy on the right. And yet we do, don't we? In fact, his name is Plato. Thank you. I'll tell Plato you did that. And what about this phrase? I mean, 15 million or more people heard Ted Danson proclaim his love of fish from Oceania's standpoint last year on Earth Day, and every day since 1987, and yet he eats them for all those years. Now, no offense to Mr. Danson, please, and maybe things have changed in the last month, but for him, 98% of all other individuals in the world, this phrase, I love fish, actually means this. I love to eat fish, doesn't it? I mean, that's what he really means. I mean, if he loved fish, as in loving his cat or his dog, he certainly wouldn't kill and eat them, would he? No, I really don't think so. Again, it's how we use our words, isn't it? So let's take a proper, more accurate look at our oceans. Fish, as well as dairy, are always the last strongholds someone has as they make their way, they move away from eating animals. And it's easy to see why. Both are so very far out of sight, they just end up mysteriously in front of you to eat somehow, don't they? But incredibly large amounts of sea life are taken from our oceans in three ways. First, they're taken as target fish, you know, the one you want to eat. Next, they're taken out of our oceans to feed other fish on factory fish farms, part of the aquaculture movement. And lastly, fish are taken out of our oceans as bykill due to the first two types of fishing. Oh, my goodness, that really doesn't leave too much in our oceans now, does it? Our oceans look like this. In fact, our oceans are being ravaged, and yet who here in this room or on this campus doesn't know that fact, that our oceans are being ravaged? Well, then how about another question? Why does everybody still eat them then? Fragile, interdependent, and poorly understood ecosystems have been devastated. 98 million tons of fish were caught in 2010, with quite a few more, hundreds of millions of tons of bykill. All those other innocent sea life caught and killed and discarded. In the process of trying to catch that target of fish that everyone's asking for, bykill includes juvenile fish, never make their way to maturity, of course, all seven of the endangered sea turtles, sea lions, birds, dolphins, I mean, even whales. I mean, come on, is this really worth it? I mean, this should be embarrassing. That's embarrassing to me, and I don't even eat fish. Of the 17 major fishing stock areas in the world, all of them are either overexploited or on the verge of collapse. 80% of the world's fish species are affected, considered heavily depleted from overfishing practices. Over 90% of all the large fish. That's quite a bit of damage. But along comes this word, sustainable. To justify continued harvesting, we can just stamp that word on anything, and then we can continue in the take mode. And better yet, we can feel good about it. Why? Well, it's sustainable. That's why. I mean, how's that word even used in the fishing industry? Who defines it? Who monitors it? Who decides on enforcement? Now, if you look at this carefully, or even not so carefully, the real answer is no one. And I say real answer because now there's sea life caught and labeled sustainable when in fact it's not. But it's still labeled as such by a number of highly respected organizations such as the Marine Stewardship Council and others. And there are many, many examples. Tuna cod, pollock, haddock, salmon, krill, hake, menhaden. The Monterey Bay Aquarium Seafood Watch, highly respected, especially here in this area of the world, has lobster from the Gulf of Maine. I have to keep checking it every day to see if it's still true. From the Gulf of Maine, from both U.S. and Canada waters, listed as a good alternative. They've had it listed that way for years. It's not. It's not a good alternative for many reasons. Rapidly declining number of lobster, inefficient trapping mechanisms, and what I think is the most important, the very sad effect lobster trapping has on the critically endangered North Atlantic right whale. There are only 450 of these truly magnificent creatures left that we haven't killed. And nearly all of them, 85% of them, are getting entangled, injured, and killed in those darn trap lines. We and the Monterey Bay Aquarium Seafood Watch, of course, owe these whales much more than this. And the same is true with everything on this list. All are considered and labeled sustainable in one way or another, but none of them are. And the list goes on and on. Cod were fished only 1% of the original numbers off the coast of Newfoundland, more recently to a near extinct status in the North Sea, while stated that they were sustainable. And what a very sad and disconcerting story krill is. In the case of hoki, the new great white fish used by McDonald's in their fish sandwich now because we've decimated the cod species, which used to be everyone's favorite fish sandwich. You know, when you run out of one fish species, what do? You just go to the next and gobble that one up. But catching hoki causes significant trawling damage, obvious loss of their own numbers. They keep dropping the quota amount, and the killing of thousands and thousands of seabirds and sea lions each year. So why are they calling that sustainable? Oh, I'm really sorry for the interruption. Just a moment. Someone would like to say something to you, so all eyes on the screen, please. Sorry. Yeah. You know, I love that movie. Especially the first one. You know, it's a shame that no one really listened to its message. A perfect example of this is with the very few endangered Western stellar sea lions that are left in the Aleutian Islands. We've been killing and eating the intelligent and talented octopus, which is considered sustainable, especially if it's from Hawaii or the Gulf of California. Octopus can be found at Whole Foods, considered our gold standard everywhere. Why are we eating octopus? We don't even understand them. And everyone in the world knows about bluefin tuna, right? Sure they do. So why do I have to say anything about it? Well, because it's a perfect example of how we manage things. Their numbers have dropped by 92%. They are already extinct in the Black and Caspian Seas, predicted to become extinct in the Mediterranean region by the end of next year. Well, we still kill and eat them. We still kill and eat other fish that impact them. We still use long lines up to 100 miles long behind fishing boats in the Gulf of Mexico where they breed and spawn. Why is that? The ruling to not grant an endangered status to bluefin tuna was made last May based primarily on interviews, if you can believe it, of the tuna fishing industry itself. Asking bluefin tuna fishermen, asking these guys right here, a series of questions to see what they think about taking away their income, their food, and what they'd like to do for fun on weekends. Brilliant. That was a brilliant idea, hence no endangered status. In fact, one of these magnificent creatures sold for $736,000 in Japan last month. That'll help, won't it? Coral reefs are in serious trouble. Most would think it's due to pollution and climate change, but the primary cause of coral reef death throughout the entire Caribbean region anyway is not pollution. And it's not from climate change, it's from overfishing. An example in the other direction can be found in the Queen's Islands off of the southern coast of Cuba, where they haven't allowed fishing. Alaskan pollock have been harvested at a rate of 3 million tons per year. 3 million tons per year. And it's still labeled as sustainable. Now, who would think you could take 3 million tons of any species from anywhere on Earth and think they wouldn't be missed? Now, here's the point regarding our oceans. It's no longer a problem of overfishing. It's about fishing. What we need is complete and immediate restoration of all oceanic ecosystems back to a balanced state where pluses and minuses occur naturally, not controlled or manipulated by our wants or by an organization such as MSC and others that are influenced by money, which they all are. We want to eat lobster so desperately, or Alaskan pollock, so therefore they're sustainable. Well, no worries, because now we have fish farms. Yeah, 48% of all fish consumed worldwide are produced from aquaculture, which is growing faster than any other food sector. And one reason for this tremendous growth is the very false illusion of environmentalism. Here we have another interesting idea where fish are caught in our already ravaged oceans to feed other fish produced on factory fish farms, sometimes at a ratio of 20 to 1 in the form of fish, fish meal, fish oil. 88% of all fish oil produced in the world is now given to these fish farms. If you're concerned about getting your omega-3 fatty acids, you need to go right to the source, which is not fish. A topic for another day. And by the way, who decides that this is humane? Does anyone know what nociceptors are, especially polymodal nociceptors? Okay, another day. There are over 4 million fishing vessels now in the world, destroying ecosystems that have been in place for millions of years. All right, our rainforests are still being lost. 25 million acres just last year. That's tragic. This is what a few thousand to a million-year-old rainforest now looks like because the world's food priorities are with eating livestock, not with being stewards of other living things, as we should be. This is the very sad result. Soon grass, pasture, and cattle will follow this in, blaming it on logging, and usually erosion, desertification, and localized climate change as well. 80% of all rainforest loss in the world is due still to raising cattle, with another 10% lost due to growing crops to feed them and other livestock. And these livestock are grazing. It's not a matter of factory farming. We've already lost numerous ancient tribes, over 90 of them, shaman, undiscovered medicinal plants, and millions of living things. We'll never see them again. They shouldn't be lost because of our inappropriate choice of foods. So it's quite easy to quantify our global depletion of land, isn't it, with far too much of it being used for the wrong purpose. You see it just about everywhere you go. This is how much land is being used to raise livestock. In the U.S. alone, nearly 78% of all land used for agriculture is used in some way to support the animals we eat. But listen to this. There are 100 million cattle in the U.S. today, 70 million pigs. Only 3% of all of those are being pastured, only 9% of all livestock in general, and yet we're still using this much land. You can produce 15 times as much protein from plants as you can from meat or animals on any given area of land. With spirulina and chlorella, it's 2,000 times more protein. You can produce 20 to 30 1,000 pounds of plant foods on 1 acre of land versus 480 pounds at best, at very best, of meat or animal products on 1 acre, regardless of what Joel Salatin and the polyphase farm proponents will tell you. It's shocking knowing it's true all over the world. Those are statistics for all over the world. Thank you. It's shocking knowing just how much land is being used for raising animals, how inefficient, seriously inefficient, this really is. There are 1 billion people suffering from hunger. This year alone, 6 million children will die from starvation. So how does that relate? 82% of the world's starving children live in countries where food is fed to animals that are then killed and eaten by more well-off individuals in developed countries like the US, UK, and in Europe. 1/4 of all grain produced by third world countries is now given to livestock, whether in their country or out. Discussing the plight of Ethiopia or Eritrea would, again, deserve and demand a few more hours, which I'd be happy to do. To be sure, world hunger has many layers of complexity. One of the larger reasons is tied to poverty, but another significant factor is the looming shadow of our current demand to eat livestock and fish, which is indirectly tied to poverty. In fact, eating these animals ultimately affects food prices, certainly affects food availability and policymaking, and it even affects, in a negative fashion, the education to improve agricultural systems in developing countries, such as the Machakos region and their many women farmers in South Kenya, which is not too far off from the slums of Kibera here. Our food choices and production systems now have far-reaching effects, with most of our global resources trapped inside of this livestock and fishing vacuum. Last year, in 2011, the stats are already in. There was a record harvest of grain in the world, 2.5 to 2.6 in between, billion tons. Half of that was fed to animals in the meat and dairy industry. 77% of all coarse grains were fed to animals. We can't blame the droughts in Russia or China or the flooding in Pakistan for the world's food security issues. We're losing other species on Earth at an unprecedented rate with such a loss of biodiversity, plants, animals, insects, that we're finding ourselves in another era of large-scale extinction. One animal extinction every 4 years used to be the norm. Today, we're witnessing over 30,000 animal extinctions per year. By the time today is over, just one day, there'll be another 82 animal species gone with it forever. The jaguar, very endangered due to loss of its habitat over the years, the unnecessary clearing of tropical rainforests to support grass-fed cattle. Closer to home, there's the red wolf, declared extinct in 1980 due to hunting and loss of its habitat in order to raise grass-fed livestock. But let's make sure we understand what's really happening here, though, with loss of biodiversity. It's not from overpopulation. It's from too many people eating the wrong type of food. The most recent convention on biological diversity was held in Nagoya, Japan, in 2010 as a follow-up to the one held in 2002. And don't ask me why they have it every 8 years. They all eat animals during the year. None of their goals for 2002 were met, not one of them. And with this last meeting in 2010, they decided to protect 17% of the remaining land in the world that's not being used by livestock, and only 10% of all of our oceans by the year 2020. Pretty ambitious, huh? Nearly all concerned researchers agree that the primary causes of the rapid biodiversity loss that we're witnessing on our planet today is by pastured or grazing livestock on land and by unsustainable fishing practices in our oceans. And yet nowhere in their resolution at Nagoya, adopted by 196 countries, is exact wording to effectively address this. Well, the most pressing concern that we have today regarding sustaining our life and future life on Earth, I mean, it's just that the scientists don't really want to spell it out, where all the water's going. But it's not Facebook. It's not the sudden loss of Facebook. And it's not the sudden loss of Twitter. It's water. And we don't have much of it, and we're using all of it. It's a regional issue, sure. I mean, there's flooding here and droughts there. But aquifers and wells are already drying up, ask the folks at Spicewood Beach, Texas. There's a growing gap between worldwide demand for water and what's really available. With so much demand, there's expected to be a 40% shortage in water supply in just 18 years. And what you decide to eat has every single thing to do with this, of course. Scientists are very concerned about water scarcity, but I think it's more a matter of water management, isn't it? Yeah, instead of focusing on technologies, I think we should be first looking at choices. Is this a good choice? How about any of these? Are any of these good choices? I mean, do you know that it requires more than 400 gallons of water just to slaughter one cow or one pig, grass-fed or not, in addition to these other figures for the act itself? And we slaughtered 145 million cows and pigs last year just in the U.S. Much of our fresh water is not fully renewable in our lifetime, and it's certainly not infinite in quantity. So how about some basics? Put this together a little bit better. Has anyone here ever taken care of or babysat a cow or a pig for a few days? Well, great. All right, I love it. Yeah, I know, you have quite a few, huh? Well, it's a great experience. Well, then you'd know that the researchers are, in fact, correct, that it does, every cow does need 20 to 30 gallons of water to drink each day, about 15 gallons for a pig, and, of course, less than half that for a chicken. Now, this is important for everyone to know, because if someone wants to eat these things, they certainly should know what's going on behind the scenes, and this is just for water, versus 0 gallons for plants. Now, this is a non-irrigated scenario for both sides of the equation. So just one of the billions and billions of animals raised each year, just one of them drinks 70 times the amount of water that one of us would or should each day of its life. An area of tremendous misuse of water and land combined is right here in your state of California, where, among other things, you use 900,000 acres of land to produce alfalfa. I'm not going to repeat that number again. That's a staggering amount of land. Why do you do that? Why do you do that? Because on average, it requires 1 to 2 million gallons of water per year to irrigate just one of those 900,000 acres, and they all get irrigated. It's very true. It's sadly true. So guess where all that alfalfa and water in it's being used? It goes to livestock. 5% to horses, the rest to livestock, 75% to dairy cows. So how does that work now for your real food dairy products being sustainable, grass-fed, locally grown, or not? The average household in our country uses 50,000 gallons of water in 1 year, according to the EPA. Indoor use, about the same outdoor use. That's quite a bit of water. It's what we're focused on in times of drought. How to reduce this? The average person in our country, though, consumes 210 pounds of meat in 1 year. It's actually a little bit more than that, but that's what we're used to hearing, divided between 45 pounds of pig, 55 pounds of cow, and 110 pounds in growing each year of chicken, which equates to 315,000 gallons of water per person per year just to support that meat diet. So now, I don't know what the EPA is thinking. So now, a more realistic view is that every household of just 3 people in the U.S., well, they use 1 million gallons of water in 1 year, not 50,000. 1 million gallons of water, 95% of that outrageous water use is from their choice of foods, a specific type of food. So whenever there's a drought or water shortage anywhere in our country, which there are, does our government or your university here ever step up and declare a state of rationing meat or dairy? Well, why not? Why shouldn't they? I think this illustration sums up the topic of pollution pretty well, don't you? I had another hour or so to talk about it, but a couple of bears dumping their waste back into the human house, called animal waste management. I think that's pretty good. Now, pollution is a very important, critical component of global depletion. We just don't have quite enough time again. Over 90% of the world chooses food that's unhealthy for them and for our planet. These are some of the reasons why. Picking out one of them, government subsidies have played a role, but not as large as some would think. They promoted the production of animal products, of course. You do have choices, though. Remember, though, that less than 3% of these government subsidies have anything to do with high fructose corn syrup. That's not the problem. And very importantly, there's a very complex and quite powerful combination of psychological, cultural, social, economic, and political interactions. So how do we solve all this? Instead of just listening to me up here complaining about it, let's do some things. Okay, so I think that nearly everything can be solved with education. That's why I wrote the book. That's why I'm writing another book. There should be a committee established at every school system. Every corporation should have, and every community should have one, who are creating opportunities for everyone to be enlightened about their food choices, to hear other perspectives, to hear more accurate definitions. You're very fortunate here at Berkeley to have this conference. And what I mean by local is to extend education to those specific areas, not here, extend it to those specific areas where there's misuse of land, water, or pollution. Those living in rainforests need to be aware of how valuable their land is if left untouched, worth much more than $43 an acre they're getting to raise cattle. Instead, the rainforest land can be used for this sustainable growing of edible plants for us, or medicinal plants like the rosy periwinkle, which gives us ventristine, or for ecotourism. We need to raise the educational base of all those in mentoring capacities. And we need to reverse the trend of tiptoeing around this subject by the media, and by authors, and by lecturers, and other educators, where we're getting all of our information from. Let's get the story straight. An important part of the solution process will be the development of new agriculture systems. Community-supported agriculture, farm-to-table, small and local farms, real food, slow food, organic, biodynamic, traceable, fair, all only make sense if they don't involve animals, for all the reasons we're talking about. And we should think seriously about what I call conversion permaculture. Essentially, it's a form of agroforestry. And of course, there's our upcoming farm bill and food policy, which is being revised as we speak. The first hearing was accomplished just on Wednesday. And why do you need to know about the farm bill? Well, you need to get involved. That's the first reason. And with any current or future farm bill, I think that all government funding should be only for those foods that are factually the healthiest for our environment and for ourselves. Organically grown plant-based foods, there shouldn't be one penny going out by us or our government to support any other type of food, period. Thank you. Yeah, absolutely. If there are, they just need to know more about it. Many of the major changes proposed for this bill are aimed at taking away economic support from factory farms and giving more to small farmers, thinking that in itself is going to produce healthier food. It's not. Essentially, it's going to be shifting funds from large meat and dairy operations to small meat and dairy operations. Well, that's not going to work, is it? So, in addition to some ideas I have on the farm bill, I have another solution dealing with accountability, which would get us on track much quicker, and it's what I call the eco and health tax. And here's how it would work. You're all familiar with the nutrition fact label. This happens to be ground beef or ground cow, something the average consumer would purchase. I want to point out that this could be grain-fed or grass-fed. It really wouldn't change much at all. And on this label, you can see that half the calories are from fat. Most of those are from saturated fat, even a gram of trans fat, and quite a bit of cholesterol. Now, all that's not so good, but you don't see not so good anywhere on the label, do you? I don't. I sure don't. And it also has quite a bit of protein, but it's of the type that's implicated in numerous disease states, all four of the leading causes of death and disease in the U.S. today, and all five of the most common types of cancer, as well as their precursors, hypertension and obesity. You certainly don't see what resources it would take either to produce whatever's inside that package. Well, consumers need to know what effect this product had on our environment while producing it, as well as what effect it'll have on our health after consuming it. So we introduced the eco and health risk factors. And in the event that these numbers are too complicated, which they probably would be, we simply do this. We put a little notation on the back. We could put this. We could put not so good. We could put not a good choice, or in the future, when all this becomes voice activated, a little Siri voice could pop out and slap your hand even and say, I wouldn't do that if I were you. intervention style, okay. Now, this is not a carbon tax. We need to reflect these factors into cost, though. And it's not a carbon tax. It's not a soda tax, which would vastly understate the problem, so it wouldn't work. It's an eco and health risk tax, something we've never done before, because the true cost to our environment and to our own health has always been externalized. It's never been directly paid for, with our heads always turned in the other direction. Well, we need to reflect the cost of the loss of topsoil, a patch of 1,000 to a million-year-old rainforest, a coral reef system, ice age water, or aquifer, or our own health, things that are invaluable. Let's reflect those in the cost. Someday, with a correct economic formulation and a more gutsy and proper policy change, we may even evolve to see this in our meat aisle, a quarter-pound beef patty, grass-fed or not, priced at over $4,000. And it would be a steal at these prices if you had to go back and replace the resources it took to produce it. Well, this is the question of the day, isn't it? It's one, not the only, but it's one of the questions of our future. It's a topic that's gaining momentum, and I find it's a natural path for most people wanting just so badly to hang on to that false sense of needing versus simply wanting to eat animal products. It's a path of least resistance, let's face it. So let's look at a couple different ways to answer this question. There you go. There you have it. That's certainly one way to answer that question. I mean, he thinks so, and he's not alone. My thought, though, is that we need to be fully aware of the consequences of our food choices, not partially aware. And we need to understand what we're doing to all areas of global depletion. And we need to know the magnitude and the urgency of the problem. You know what? It's not a go meatless on Monday type of problem, and we're going to take a look at that in just a moment. So let's take a look at another way to answer this question, at how sustainable raising grass-fed livestock really is. Well, in many ways, greenhouse gases, all but from nitrous oxide, would actually increase, as methane production, according to some, is four times, but minimally 50 to 60% higher in grass-fed cattle and for a longer period of time, two and a half, 3 years instead of 1 year. Regarding land use, this is really easy. It doesn't make much sense to use more than the 38% of all land we're already using on Earth. You can ask all the other millions of species what their take is on this one. Now, we've already spent quite a bit of time discussing water already, so we know that raising grass-fed animals isn't so sustainable from that standpoint. And it'll have the same overall effect on depletion of our own health. What you've been hearing about the purported health benefits of grass-fed beef, they're higher in omega-3s and they're lower in saturated fat, et cetera, it's quite misleading because they're comparing it to grain-fed beef, which is minimally better than instead of plants. 100 years ago, back in 1910, when everybody wants us to go back and eat what our great-grandmothers were eating, and when everybody in the U.S. had been eating their fair share of grass-fed cattle, long before the commercialization of food, long before high fructose corn syrup, the leading cause of death back then, in 1910, just ahead of tuberculosis, was guess what? It was heart disease. Just like it is today, from eating too much saturated fat, too much cholesterol, too much of the type of protein from all those grass-fed animal products, and not enough fiber, not enough micronutrients, not enough phytonutrients, or even anti-angiogenic substances, all that can only be found in plants. So then, this is another food term that's being misused. It's the word sustainable. What authors, lecturers, decision makers really mean, what they're really thinking when they're using this word is this. Somebody told me or said it's okay to do it this way. Or very possibly they're thinking this, this worked for me. When in fact it may not be sustainable at all. Most CEOs of any large corporation today or presidents of universities will pull out a long list of things this word means to them. They'll have to. But they're going to be thinking this, food with a question mark. I wasn't aware that food had a role, meaning they may be doing the best they can in all other areas of sustainability, energy, waste, economic, but how much attention have they given to food choice? And then the next level up to the animals that we eat in implementation or education. So would that qualify them and their businesses or institutions as sustainable? No. No, it would not. So I think it's time to go to the very essence of this whole problem. We're going to give everyone in this room 1 acre of land to grow any food you choose. What would you grow? What should you grow? Well, I mentioned frequently that at all my other college and university lectures, the students know what they want to grow. Yeah, I haven't figured out what that is yet. They haven't told me, but they asked me if they can grow this, marijuana. I tell them, sure, it's a great idea. It's quite nutritious. Probably should be the male hemp plant, and we're trying to talk about food here. Well, on this acre we give you, you could raise 1 grass-fed cow, just like many would want you to, thinking it's fully sustainable, like that New York Times best-selling author does. But in most areas of the world, 1 acre isn't nearly enough. You're going to need 5, 10, 20, even 25 acres, so you'd have to borrow some land from your neighbor for that cow. Quite a few acres are needed. You've already lost the game. You're already off on the wrong foot. Or you could go this route, and you could plant something like this on just half your acre. You could plant, what is this? Kale. Yeah, absolutely, great. You could plant any one of a number of thousands of different types of plants, but kale has an amazing assortment of micronutrients. In fact, kale has over 60 different thus far recognized phytonutrients. Each one of these will individually increase your immune response, help reduce the likelihood you'll develop cancer, and it'll provide you with many, many anti-inflammatory properties. Inflammation is a major component of most of the disease states we're seeing today. You can't find any of these phytonutrients in your cow, not one of them. Kale has a perfect ratio of omega-3 fatty acids, and it has fiber. You can't find that in your cow either. When looking at global growing applications, how cool is this? Kale will actually continue to grow through extremes of temperatures from -5 degrees, like back in my backyard. That's snow you see there, in case you don't know what that white stuff is. From that, all the way through 100 degrees Fahrenheit. And after you pick the leaves, does anybody know what happens to kale leaves? They grow back. They regenerate. I bet your cow can't do that. And on the other half an acre you have left over, you could plant this. You could plant quinoa or any one of a number of thousands of different types of foods. This is another power food, though, of course. Provides a gluten-free source of protein, a balanced and complete amino acid profile. It's quite healthy. So there you have it. If you used your 1 acre plus many acres of borrowed land for grass-fed livestock, you'd end up with 100 to 400 pounds of a type of food that's implicated in numerous disease states. And along the way, you've produced 3 to 4 tons of methane and carbon dioxide, and you've used minimally 30,000 gallons of water. In most cases, you're going to use 1 million to 2 million gallons of water for that one cow. Or instead, if you use your acre of land to grow something like this kale and quinoa combination, you've produced 15,000 pounds of food that's infinitely healthier for you to eat and for our planet to grow. Any of you like tomatoes? Lycopene and all? Yeah, sure, you could sliver off in just an eighth of an acre, and you could put in hydroponics, and you could grow 30,000 pounds of them on that little eighth of an acre in the period of time that it'd take to grow your cow. With all the kale, quinoa, and tomatoes, you could feed yourself and your friends, and you could feed some to your family and to your neighbors, and you'll even have a few thousand pounds of wonderful, fantastic food left over. So you know what you could do? You could box some of that great food up, and you could send it to all those starving children in Ethiopia or Eritrea. It can be done. It's quite an amazing difference, isn't it? And now imagine extrapolating that model out, or variations thereof, in terms of global use of our resources. And now answer that question about how sustainable raising grass-fed livestock really is. That's what I'm asking here, before I was dismissed from the farm. No, not really. And if we still have difficulties, if anybody here or elsewhere has any difficulty in thinking that any animal product is still sustainable or very sustainable or fully sustainable, well, then it's time to introduce this concept, isn't it? Relative sustainability. Yeah, that's better. That's what we need. That's going to work. This is the way we need to start viewing things from this day forward. So it's time to go back to that very first photo that we saw, that you need to know that this is in a northeast section of Victoria, Australia, where I was researching the ecological effects of their food choices. And instead of seeing beautiful blue skies and rolling hills and green grass, I like looking at things a little closer. So I got out of the car and I went a little closer, and here's what I see there. I see this: depletion of land, air, food, water, inefficient use of our resources, and I also see something else, which is the main reason I visited this specific area to research. So lock in this view, please. We're all going to just advance. We're going to walk down just a few hundred yards down the road, and this is what we see. This 1,000-year-old forest is what that cattle ranch used to be. And it was a home to numerous insects, plants, and animals. There are 3 different types of eucalyptus trees growing here, and one animal in particular that I was looking for, which is now endangered due to destroying his home. It's this little guy. All of his family members were killed. Thousands are each year. He now lives in a small, remote rescue area in that forest, and he represents species everywhere on our planet that are being devastated by cattle and other livestock operations on land, grass-fed operations on land, and fishing in our oceans. Lack of awareness about food choice and politics. In fact, koalas are predicted to become extinct in just 20 years by those very few researchers and kind caretakers who are close to the situation. It's quite sad. And that's what I see in that very first photo. So when I mentioned that our global depletion due to food choice is not a go meatless on Monday type of problem, this is what I mean. I mean, it's not enough. We need to be constantly aware of the fact that if your choice of food involves animals, that means all livestock, grass-fed or not, it's the driving force behind global depletion. It's very, very real. And therefore, it needs to be dealt with correctly. For instance, you've all heard that we need to vote with our forks, right? Of course, everybody's heard that. Vote with your forks. Well, don't do that. It's something we've been doing for the past 50 years. And look where it's gotten us. No, what we need to do is give ourselves more credit than that, and then actually becoming more aware of our food choices, and then voting with our minds first, and let our forks follow. When you go to the farmer's market, one of the 7,000 now, let the local farmers know that you support them. Let them know that you want organically produced food, nothing that comes from raising animals, because that uses too much water and too much land and affects our atmosphere and our health. But let them know this. Guide them. Influence them. Again, you're going to be voting with your minds, not your forks. And now, about the Go Meatless on Monday campaign. Okay, if you do this, if you go meatless on Mondays, you'll be contributing to global warming, pollution, global depletion of our planet's resources, and your own health on only 6 days of the week. Instead of 7, you're going to be creating a false justification for your actions on those other 6 days of the week. In other words, let's not rest on the laurels of what you're doing right only 1/7 of the time. Two little buddies discussing global depletion here. We've seen tremendous progress lately with increased public awareness of all the ill effects of factory farming, haven't we? And as a start, this is a good thing, but make no mistake that for every bit of progress this seems to be, there's an equally strong message tagging insidiously along with it, telling everyone that it's still okay, it's perfectly fine to continue raising, slaughtering, and eating billions of animals. Only now, instead of with factory farms, well, we can accomplish it by using pastures and small family farms. And now we can use our oceans, and guess what? We can now use the word sustainable to conveniently hide behind. That's the message that we're all hearing. What we don't hear, of course, is that we're still hurting all the animals, our planet, and ourselves. So, for all the millions and millions of people that are being told that fish and grass-fed livestock are sustainable, healthy, and humane, well, there needs to be a louder and a clearer voice reminding them that it's not. And baby steps. What are those? I mean, I think it's time we do away with baby steps because, well, we're in fact not babies, are we? I mean, if you think about it, all of us are quite capable of taking big person steps right now. And our planet and all the animals on it shouldn't have to wait with repeated and ongoing assault until we get this figured out. Thank you. So in my spare time, I took a look at your sustainability policy right here at UC Berkeley, there it is, which happens to be the policy at all UC campuses. And although a good start with the food service component, is this sustainable? How about the items I just highlighted in orange? Are those sustainable? Where does this policy fit in terms of relative sustainability? Or are these merely baby steps that happen to affect 500,000 students, faculty, and staff? Wouldn't it be nice for all universities and institutions worldwide to have another, perhaps more accurate reference point when making food choice decisions? There is now a nonprofit organization that can do this by way of a definitive appraisal. It's called Inspire Awareness Now. And it's a call to education, and it's a call to action. We're only here on Earth for what can be considered a fleeting moment of time. And yet we can do this much damage to ourselves and to our planet because of the choices we make. So ask yourself on a daily basis this simple question. Is the food you're about to eat in the best interest of all living things? And if not, well, don't eat it. There's a great opportunity for all of you to have a leading role in not only being the change that Gandhi so eloquently advocated years and years ago, but also creating change, creating the food choice change that's necessary for our survival of our planet. Ears are starting to perk up and listen, minds and doors are starting to open, and this is just the beginning. And that's what I see. And it's a wonderful, wonderful thing, just like Solomon here. So I encourage and challenge everyone to continue becoming more aware about your food choices. Seek more accurate definitions. And then let's all commit to making a difference, but not just with our own health or with our own life. No, let's all commit to making a difference in someone else's life. And let's commit to making a difference in the long-term health of our planet. That's what sustainability, true sustainability, and positive change to achieve it, I think, is really all about. So with that in mind, let's all of us inspire others to become aware. Thank you so very much for your time. It's been my privilege to be here. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Richard Oppenlander. Let's give him a big round of applause. It's awesome. Amazing. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for being here.
Thank you, all of you. I really appreciate it. Thank you so much.